Consider here more specifically whose wrath it is. It is the wrath of the infinite God. If it were only the wrath of man, even the wrath of the strongest prince, it would not compare with God's. People dread the wrath of kings, especially of dictators, who have people's lives and possessions totally under their power, and can dispose of them at their mere will. Proverbs 20 verse 2 says, "The wrath of a king is like the roaring of a lion. Whoever provokes him to anger sins against his own life." An individual who greatly enrages a tyrannical prince will probably suffer the most extreme torments that human beings can invent or inflict. Yet the greatest earthly rulers in all their majesty and strength, when displaying their greatest terrors, are but feeble, despicable worms of the dust in comparison with the great and almighty Creator and King of heaven and earth. They accomplish very little, even when they are greatly enraged and have exhibited the fullness of their fury. All the kings of the earth are like grasshoppers before God. They are nothing, and even less than nothing. Both their love and their hatred are to be despised. The wrath of the great King of Kings is much more terrible than theirs, just as his majesty is greater as well. Luke 12, verses 4 and 5 says, "I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after he is killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear him. The fierceness of his wrath is what you are subject to." We often read of the fury of God, as in Isaiah 59, verse 18, "According to their deeds, accordingly he will repay fury to his adversaries, recompense to his enemies. The coastlands he will fully repay." Likewise, Isaiah 66, verse 16 says, "For by fire and by his sword the Lord will judge all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many." Also in many other places, such as Revelation 19, verse 15, we read, "He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God." These words are extremely terrible. If the verse had only said, "the wrath of God," the words would have spoken of something infinitely dreadful. But it says, "the fierceness and wrath." It is the fury of God, the fierceness of Jehovah. Oh, how dreadful that must be. Who can speak or think about what such expressions imply? Moreover, it is the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God, as if to emphasize a great display of his almighty power in what his fierce wrath inflicts. As men are in the habit of showing their strength through the fierceness of their wrath, God's unlimited power is enraged and put into action. Oh, what will be the consequence then? What will happen to the poor worm who shall suffer his wrath? Whose hands are strong enough, and whose heart can bear the pain? What a dreadful, inexpressible, and inconceivable depth of misery the poor creature will sink to who shall be the object of this wrath. For those present here who remain unconverted, consider this. When the verse says that God will carry out the fierceness of his anger, it means that he will inflict his wrath without any pity. When God observes your indescribable punishment and sees your extreme torment to be far more than your strength can bear, and that it is crushing you and making you sink into infinite gloom, he will have no compassion on you. He will not refrain from carrying out his wrath or lighten his hand in the least. There shall be no moderation or mercy, nor will God hold back his rough wind. He will have no regard for your welfare, nor will he be the least bit careful that you do not suffer too much, except that you do not suffer beyond what justice requires. Nothing will be withheld because it is too hard for you to bear. Ezekiel 8, verse 18 says, "Therefore I also will act in fury. My eye will not spare, nor will I have pity. And though they cry in my ears with a loud voice, I will not hear them." For now, God stands ready to have pity on you. This is a day of mercy. Now you may cry with the hope of obtaining mercy. But once the day of mercy is past, your most serious and desperate cries for mercy will be in vain. You will be forever lost, and God will throw you away, no longer giving thought to your welfare. God will have no other use for you except to make you suffer misery. You shall exist for no other purpose. You will be objects of his wrath, prepared for destruction. And there will be no other use for those objects but to be filled full of God's wrath. God will be so far from pitying you when you cry to him that the Bible says he will only laugh and mock. How awful are the words of the great God in Isaiah 63:3, for I have trodden them in my anger and trampled them in my fury. Their blood is sprinkled upon my garments, and I have stained all my robes. It is perhaps impossible to find words that express more vividly the idea of contempt, hatred, and fierce anger. If you cry to God for pity, he will be far from pitying you in your sad state of showing you the least favor. Instead, he will only trample you under his feet. Although he will know that you cannot bear the weight of his unlimited power treading on you, he will not think twice but will still crush you under his feet without mercy. He will crush you until your blood splatters, sprinkling his garments and staining all of his clothes. Not only will he hate you, but he will hold you in the highest contempt. The only place fit for you will be under his feet, to be stomped on like the filthy mud in the streets. The misery you will be exposed to will be for the purpose of showing what the wrath of God is. God has wanted to show men and angels both how great his love is and how terrible his wrath is. Sometimes when kings want to display the extent of their wrath, they do so by severely punishing those who provoke them. Nebuchadnezzar, the mighty and arrogant king of the Chaldean Empire, was willing to show his wrath when he was angered by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He gave the order to heat the fiery furnace 7 times hotter than it was before. It was probably raised to the hottest degree man was capable of producing. In the same way, the great God is also willing to show his wrath and magnify his awesome majesty and mighty power in the extreme sufferings of his enemies. Romans 9:22 says, "What if God, wanting to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction? Even more, because this display of his unrestrained wrath, fury, and fierceness is part of his plan, we know he will do it to its fullest degree. What will be accomplished and brought to pass will be dreadful to witness. When the great and angry God has risen up and executed his terrifying vengeance on the poor sinner, and the wretch is actually suffering the infinite weight and power of his anger, then God will call upon the whole universe to behold the awful majesty and mighty power displayed in it. Isaiah 33, verses 12 to 14 says, "The people shall be like the burnings of lime, like thorns cut up. They shall be burned in the fire. Hear, you who are far off, what I have done, and you who are near, acknowledge my might. The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has seized the hypocrites. Who among us shall dwell with a devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings?" This is how it will be for you who are unconverted if you continue in your unbelief. The infinite might, majesty, and terribleness of the all-powerful God shall be magnified on you in the inexpressible severity of your torment. You shall be tormented in the presence of the holy angels and also in the presence of the Lamb. While you're in this state of suffering, the blessed inhabitants of heaven will go and look upon the dreadful sight so that they may see what the wrath and fierceness of the Almighty is. When they see it, they will fall down and adore such great power and majesty. Isaiah 66, verses 23 and 24 says, "From one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, all shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. And they shall go forth and look upon the corpses of the men who have transgressed against me. For their worm does not die, and their fire is not quenched. They shall be an abhorrence to all." It is an everlasting wrath. It would be dreadful to suffer this fierceness and wrath of Almighty God for even one moment. But you will suffer it for all eternity. There will be no end to this intense and horrible misery. When you look ahead, you will see a long forever, an unlimited length of time before you. This will swallow up all of your thoughts. It will amaze your soul, and you will be in absolute despair of ever being delivered, a of its ever coming to an end, or of receiving any reduction of torment or any rest at all. You will know for sure that you must wear out many long ages, millions and millions of ages, in struggling and fighting against this merciless vengeance. When you have struggled and fought through all these many ages, you will realize that hardly a second has gone by, and eternity still remains. Your punishment will be infinite. Oh, who can express the horrible state of a soul in that condition? All that we can possibly say about it is only a very feeble and faint image of what it will be like. It is inexpressible and inconceivable, for who knows the power of God's anger? How dreadful is the state of those who are in danger of this great wrath and infinite misery every hour of every day. Yet this is the dark and gloomy condition of every soul in this congregation who has not been born again, however moral and strict, serious and religious he or she may be. Oh, that you would consider this. Whether you are young or old, there is reason to think that many in this congregation now listening to this message will actually suffer this very misery for all eternity. We do not know who they are, or where they are seated, or what they may now be thinking. It could be that they are now at ease and remain undisturbed by hearing all these things, assuring themselves that they are not the ones spoken of, and promising themselves that they will escape. If we knew that there was even one person in this whole congregation who would suffer such misery, what an awful thing it would be to think of. Even more, if we knew who that person was, how horrifying it would be to see the person in such a state. All the rest of the congregation would lift up a sorrowful, bitter cry over him. But I tell you, it is likely that not just one, but many will remember this sermon while they are in hell. It would be surprising if some who are now present here were not in hell in a very short while, even before this year is over. I would not be amazed if some people now sitting here in this service in good health, content, and secure were there before tomorrow morning. Those of you who live and stay out of hell longer than others will surely be there before long. Your damnation is not sleeping. It will come swiftly, and most likely very suddenly upon many of you. You have good reason to wonder why you are not in hell already. I am sure that you have seen or known people who deserved hell no more than you, and who seem as likely to remain alive as you. But now they are beyond hope. They are crying in extreme misery and complete despair. But here you are in the land of the living and in the house of God, and you have an opportunity to obtain salvation. What would those poor, damned, hopeless souls not give for the opportunity you now have? Now you have an extraordinary opportunity. This day, Christ has thrown the door of mercy wide open and stands calling and crying with a loud voice to poor sinners. Many are flocking to him and pressing into his kingdom. They are coming daily from the east and the west, from the north and the south. Many who until very recently were in the same miserable condition that you are in now are happy, their hearts filled with love for him who has loved them and washed them from their sins in his own blood. They are rejoicing in hope of the glory of God. How terrible it would be to be left behind in such a day, to see others feasting while you are grieving and perishing. How awful it would be to see so many people rejoicing and singing with joy from their hearts while you can do nothing but mourn and feel sorrow in your heart and cry because your spirit is so afflicted. How can you rest for one moment if you are now in that condition? Are not your souls as valuable as the souls of the people at Suffield, where they are flocking every day to Christ? Are there not many here who have lived long in this world, but still are not born again? They are aliens of the Commonwealth of Israel. All they have done for themselves since they were born is store up wrath for the coming day. Older men, you especially are in extreme danger. The guilt and hardness of your hearts are extremely great. Have you not noticed how often people of your years are passed over and left behind during this present wonderful time of God's mercy? You need to consider yourselves and thoroughly awaken out of your sleep. You cannot bear the fierceness of the infinite God. As for you young men and young women, will you neglect this precious time you are now enjoying, when so many others your age are renouncing their youthful sins and flocking to Christ? You especially have an extraordinary opportunity. But if you neglect it, you will soon be like the other young people who spent all their precious days of youth in sin and have now gone to that dreadful place full of blindness and hardness. As for you children who are unconverted, do you not know that you are going to hell to bear the dreadful wrath of God, who is now angry with you every day and every night? Will you be content to be the children of the devil when so many other children in the land are being converted and becoming the holy and happy children of the King of Kings? Now let every one who is still without Christ and hanging over the pit of hell, whether old men or women, middle-aged people, young people or children, answer to the loud calls of God's word and providence. This acceptable year of the Lord, a time of such great blessing to some, will surely be a day of remarkable vengeance to others. People's hearts become hard and their guilt increases if they neglect their souls in such a day as this. Never was there such danger of people being given to hardness of heart and blindness of mind. God now seems to be quickly gathering in his elect in all parts of the land, and probably the majority of adults who will ever be saved will be brought in shortly. It will be like the great outpouring of the Spirit upon the Jews in the days of the apostles. The elect will obtain salvation, and the rest will be blinded. If the latter is true of you, you will eternally curse this day, as well as the day you were born. You have seen this great outpouring of God's Spirit, but will wish you had died and gone to hell before you had seen it. Now especially, as in the days of John the Baptist, the axe is laid at the roots of the trees, so that every tree that does not bring forth good fruit will be cut down and cast into the fire. Therefore, let everyone who is without Christ now wake up and flee from the wrath to come. The wrath of Almighty God is now, without a doubt, hanging over a great part of this congregation. Let everyone flee from Sodom. Escape for your life. Do not look behind you, nor stay anywhere in the plain. Escape to the mountains, lest you be destroyed.